as we continue with our Bible study, lessons from the Sermon on the Mount, part number 22. Lessons from the Sermon on the Mount, part number 22. We are still looking at "You are the light of the world." Matthew 5, verse 14 to 16. You are the light of the world. Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 to 16. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Hallelujah. Yeah, we got to where we are to be shining our light, or how to shine our light, you know, in the world. And then one of the preconditions is that our eyes must be single. And that is in Matthew chapter 6, verses 22 to 24. Matthew 6, 22 to 24 was one of the things we came across, that our eye must be single for us to shine as the light of the world. Say, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thy eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and Mammon. Hallelujah. And so from last week, God, you know, narrowed our focus on this verse 24. And last week it was a question, are you serving God or Mammon? That was the question that we started, you know, looking at. Hallelujah. You know, it's a direct question, you know, to us individually and to his church. Are we serving God or Mammon? Am I serving God or Mammon? Hallelujah. And we will continue with that, you know, thought, because we didn't finish. And today, with just a little variation of what we started looking at last Tuesday, and that would be the vanity of serving Mammon. The vanity of serving Mammon. Hallelujah. Just, you know, we read a lengthy scripture, 1 Timothy 6, verse 1 to 12. We will still be referring to it, you know, later in the course of our study. But just a quick recap before we move on what we learned last week. You know, we say Mammon, or the God that controls money, is the only thing contending against our total and complete devotion to God. You know, in that verse 24, you would think Jesus will say, you cannot serve God and the devil, you know, etc. But he said, no, you cannot serve God and what? And Mammon. And so that tells us that Mammon, or the God that controls money, or the God that actually controls wealth, you know, is the only contending force that contends with our devotion to God. But, you know, we said anyone serving Mammon is actually serving the devil. It's just that the devil will not, you know, appear and say, I am the devil, serve me. We saw how he paraded the glory of the world, even to Jesus, showed him all the cities of the world and their glory, and said, if you will just fall down and worship me, all shall be thine. Hallelujah. So anyone worshiping Mammon is actually worshiping who? The devil. It's actually worshiping the devil. We'll also, you know, learn that until the issue of Mammon has been permanently settled in our heart, we will keep halting between God and Mammon. One time we will be devoted to the serving and the worship of Mammon. Another time we'll be devoted to God. Maybe we hear a message that touches us. We will not say, oh, I need to be committed to God. But all of it is environmental. When we leave that environment of conviction, Mammon will take over. And so it's something that we must settle in our heart to be singularly committed to serving God alone. We must settle it in our heart. I will not serve Mammon. I will not live for Mammon all the days of my life. Hallelujah. Finally, before we move into what the Lord will, you know, be bringing to us, one of the greatest deceptions of the enemy is to make us believe that we can serve both God and Mammon. That is one of the greatest deceptions of the wicked. And so you see many people trying to be dedicated to God and at the same time be dedicated to Mammon. But unfortunately, it is impossible. It's an impossibility. You cannot be dedicated to God and be dedicated to Mammon. You have to choose who to serve. That's what Jesus said. You cannot serve God and Mammon. It is not possible. Hallelujah. And so the question is, what we are looking at is, you know, continuing the same line, but the vanity of serving Mammon, the vanity of serving Mammon. Those serving Mammon are only dedicated to making it in life. Those that are serving Mammon are what? Only dedicated to making it in life. You know, somebody will tell you, no, I'm not serving Mammon. I just want to make it in life. I want us to know very clearly that if you are dedicated, if your passion and pursuit, you know, is just to make it in life, you are actually serving Mammon. While those serving God are only committed to the advancement of God's kingdom. And so you can't combine the two. You are either committed to the advancement of God's kingdom or you are dedicating your entire life to making it. Hallelujah. And unfortunately, you know, that has become the gospel of our day, the gospel of how people will make it. And so people are, you know, dedicating their life, devoting their time to God, not for the advancement of the kingdom, but for God to help them to make it. You remember last week we said some people, God is not, you know, the end for them. God is just what? A means to the end. Mammon is their goal. They are just using God. God, prosper me. Lord, grant me breakthrough. Lord, grant me victory. You know, in this my business. Lord, grant me unprecedented financial, you know, blessing. It's not for anything else. It's for themselves. And so those serving Mammon are dedicated to making it in life. Those serving God are what? Committed to the advancement of the kingdom of heaven. You know, that is why Jesus, you know, as he continued his teaching and he got to verse 33, and he said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God. He didn't say seek to make it in life. Hallelujah. He didn't say seek to prosper, seek to break through. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness. And what will happen? All other things shall be added unto you. And you will, we know from that scripture, it is the things you are supposed to seek for that will be added to you. So you will discover that if you are truly living for the kingdom of God, you don't need to, you know, also have an agenda of, I want to make it in life. Hallelujah. Those serving God are committed only to the advancement of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. What is first in your life is an indication of who you're serving. What is first in your life is an indication. You remember what Jesus says, but seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What is first in your life is an indication of who you are serving. And it doesn't matter what you are doing or where you are in life presently. If you are serving God, then God and his kingdom will be first in your life. Hallelujah. Those that are serving God, it doesn't matter where they are. It doesn't matter their position, their vocation. They may be students. Hallelujah. Who say God cannot be first in the life of a student? Those serving God, even though they are students, God is first. Hallelujah. Those in a career field, even though they are pursuing, they are in a career, but who is first? God is first. Those that are doing business, money is not first. They are not out to make profit by all means. No, God is first. That is why we say what is first in your life is a determinant of who you are serving. Or who is first in your life is a determinant of who you are serving. If you are serving God, there is no point in life, or in your lifetime, that God will take the back burner. God will remain first. Hallelujah. God will remain first in your life. Those that are serving Mammon are about their business. Those that are serving Mammon, they are about their business. The advancement of God's kingdom is something they think about only when they have a spare time for it. They are about their business. It is their business. It is their life. They may come to church, but they are about themselves. Remember, they may be dedicated to God, but it is for who? For themselves. It's not for the advancement of the kingdom. Those serving Mammon are about their own business. You know, that brings a very simple question. Whose business are you pursuing? Whose business am I pursuing? Are you pursuing God's business or you're pursuing your business? Am I pursuing God's business or I am pursuing my own business? That will tell me who I am serving. That will tell you who you are serving. You cannot be about God's business and at the same time be pursuing your own business. Hallelujah. Those serving God are only about God's business. They don't have any other business. They don't have any other agenda. They don't have any other pursuit in life. Those serving God are only about God's business. There is nothing else that they are living for. There is nothing else that they are living for. Why? They are about God's business. Hallelujah. Look at the life of Jesus. Very young, at a very young age, at the age of 12, in chapter 2, verses 48 and 49. Luke chapter 2, verses 48 and 49. At a very young age, you remember the parents went, to the feast, the yearly feast. And Jesus, was mixed in the crowd or stayed behind in Jerusalem. The parents didn't know until after about a day's journey. When they saw that he was not among their kinfolks, they went back. And that is where the reading pick up from. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, remember he was only how old? 12. And he said unto them, how is it that you sought me? Wist you not that I must be about my father's business? Don't you know I must be about my father's business? That is why I say it doesn't matter your level in life. If you are serving God, you will be about God's business. Hallelujah. Those that are serving God are about God's business. There is nothing else that they are living for. Look at him now. He has, begun his ministry in Mark chapter 5. Chapter 1, verses 35 to 38. In Mark chapter 1, verses 35 to 38, he has begun his ministry. He was past the age of 30 now. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place. and there prayed. And Simon and they that were with him followed after. And when they had found him, they said unto him, all men seek for thee. Hallelujah. All men seek for thee. But hear what he said. That is not why I came. In verse 38, and he said unto them, let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also. For therefore came I forth. Hallelujah. For therefore, you see him stating the reason why he came. I must be about my father's business. The years he spent on earth, it wasn't about anything. He wasn't pursuing any personal ambition. I must be about my father's business. That is why I came. Men were trooping after him. But he said, it is not just to gather crowd in one place that I came. I came to preach the gospel. Let us move to another town because I'm preached there also. For that is why I came. Hallelujah. And so whose business are you pursuing? Those that serve God pursue God's business. Hallelujah. And I want you to know, it doesn't matter your profession. You can pursue God's business there. It doesn't matter what you are doing in life. You know, sometimes we can look at people who are even in the wrong religion, serving the God that cannot save. And yet these people are so committed to their God that everything they do, everything about their life is about their religion. Everything. Their life is about their religion. When they are in any nation, it is to advance their religion. When they are in any business, it is to establish their religion. And yet we, the children of light, we have, you know, bought into a deception of pursuing our things instead of advancing the kingdom of God. May God cause, you know, help us to wake up from our slumber in the precious name of Jesus. Hallelujah. For those serving God, the preaching of the gospel is a necessity for them. For those serving God, the preaching of the gospel is a necessity for them. Everything else they do is just a means for them to preach the gospel. Hallelujah. That is when we have truly begun to serve, you know, God, and nothing else will distract us. Though serving God, preaching the gospel is not when it is convenient. It's what? It's a necessity. That means it is something they can't live without. Hallelujah. When you say something is a necessity, you can't live without that thing. When the preaching of the gospel becomes a necessity to us, then we actually have committed our life to serving God. Nothing else can distract us. But when the preaching of the gospel is not yet a necessity, we can be distracted into serving Mammon and forget about serving God. Hallelujah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16, and then verses 19 to 23. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16, and verse 19 to 23. Look at what the scripture says. The apostle Paul was talking about himself, you know, while he was here on the earth. Verse 16, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of. For necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Take note, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of. There is nothing for me to glory about when I preach the gospel. Why? For necessity is laid upon me. That is somebody who has committed his entire life and the entire reason for his existence to the preaching of the gospel. A necessity. It was not something he did out of convenience. A necessity is laid upon me. He added, yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. How I pray that every genuine child of God will come to this point, that the preaching of the gospel, the advancement of the kingdom of God will be a necessity or become a necessity to us in the precious name of Jesus. Then from verse 19 to 23, look at what he said. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I may gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I may gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without law, as without law, being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law. To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am met all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Hallelujah. Take note of that, verse 22. I am made all things to all men. Hallelujah. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. And this I do for the gospel's sake. Why did he become all things to all men? For the gospel's sake. Hallelujah. And so as far as he was concerned, the preaching of the gospel is the reason why he is living on the earth. It can become, you know, the only reason for our living on the earth when we truly embrace serving God, when we truly embrace worshiping God. Hallelujah. If we don't get to this point, we will still be distracted by Mammon in our, you know, in our pursuit and walk on the earth. We must get to this point of saying, preaching and advancing the gospel is a necessity for me. There is nothing else that I am living for. If we don't get to that point, you will still be halting between God and Mammon. Hallelujah. So those that are serving God, everything else they do is just a means for them to preach the gospel. Everything else they do, they may be in a career. There is not because of money that are in a career. They enter the career so that it, because God sent them there, because that is where God wants to use them. Hallelujah. They may start a business. It's not the profit for themselves they are looking for. It is because God told them, start a business for me, for the advancement of my kingdom. May everything about us be about the advancement of God's kingdom in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, we said we are considering the vanity, you know, of serving Mammon. Mammon will make you believe that if you don't have money, if you don't have cars, if you don't have houses, if you don't have designer's clothes, if you don't have the latest electronics, and on, the list is unending. You know, when you are serving Mammon, what you want to possess and own, the list is unending. But Mammon will make you believe if you don't have these things, then you have not yet met it in life. If you don't have these things, you have not yet met it in life. And so all the pursuit, the dedication, the commitment of multitudes is how to grab these things. You know, that is what they are laying down their lives for. You remember we said last week, if you choose to serve Mammon, Mammon demands you lay down your life. Is that not so? If you choose to serve God, God also demands that you what? That you lay down your life. Unfortunately, multitudes are laying down their life for Mammon. Not because they are just hardworking. No, there are things they must get. Hallelujah. That is the reason for all the competition in life. That is the reason for all the comparison in life. Because Mammon is telling them subtly, if you don't have these things, you are not driving a 2020 car. You are not prosperous. You are not prosperous. You don't have a mansion. No, you have not yet made it. And so many are dedicating their lives to making it in life. They don't know that it's actually Mammon that is driving them on. My prayer is that may my life not be driven by Mammon in the precious name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That is Mammon. Mammon will tell you, if you don't have these things, in fact, your value in life is based on what you have. And that is how the world has actually, you know, made life look like. That it is your value is based on the things that you have and the things that you own. But look at what Jesus said to us in Luke chapter 12 and verse 15. Look at what Jesus said. Contrary to whatever Mammon will tell you. And he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. For a man's life consists not in the abundance of the things which he what? Possess. Our life, your life does not consist in the abundance of the things that you possess. Hallelujah. No, there is more to life than things that we own. There is more to life than things that we can have. That is not what determines what our life is. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You remember when Jesus was on earth, he will even say, you know, that he, the Son of Man, has nowhere to lay his head. Foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man have nowhere, you know, to lay his head. Hallelujah. If we don't make up our mind, I am telling you, to free ourselves from the deception of Mammon, it will be difficult to be truly, you know, committed to serving God and to working with God. You know, in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 36 to 40, in Hebrews 11, verses 36 to 40, there is a caption of, you know, some of the heroes of faith that have already made it to heaven. Now, if they were serving Mammon, they will not live this kind of life. Listen to what the Bible says about them when they were here on the earth. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, they were tempted, they were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. Now take note of what God added, of whom the world was not worthy. The world was not worthy of these people. But when they were in the world, what do you think the world was thinking of them? Oh, look at these poor people. Look at these wretched people. I mean, look at some of their clothing that they wore sheepskins and goat skins. They were, you know, they were destitute. They were afflicted. They were tormented. But the Bible says, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth, all because of persecution for the name of the Lord. This was where they were. They wandered about in deserts, in mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. And this all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. Why? God having provided some better things for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. These are heroes of faith. They are listed in the scriptures. They are already in heaven. Hallelujah. I mean, we should have everything. If we don't free ourselves from Mammon, it cannot be the same heaven that, you know, these people have gone to that we are heading to. If they were thinking about making it in life, this is not the kind of life they will have lived. This is not the kind of life they will have chosen. No, they committed themselves to working with God and to serving God. Hallelujah. Mammon will make the temporal things of this life appear as the real things. Mammon will make the temporal things of this life appear as the real things, so that you will remain obscured about the reality of life. That's the aim of Mammon. It will make the temporal things of this life, you know, as the real things. They will, if you don't, you remember what we say, if you don't have them, it's like, no, you've not yet made it. It is Mammon that is pushing us like that. Make the temporal things of this life as the real things. And the reason is to obscure us about the realities of life. Hallelujah. To obscure us about the reality of life. One thing we must know is this. The true riches of life are not monetary. Neither are they things that money can buy. The true riches. But you know, Mammon will tell you, this is true riches. If you have these things, you are a rich person. But the true riches of life is not monetary, neither is it things that money can buy. The true riches of life are spiritual. Hallelujah. The true riches of life are spiritual. Just a few scripture, you know, to let us see. In Luke 16 and verse number 11, the Bible in the book of Luke chapter 16 and verse number 11, you know, if you read verse 10 to 12, it's a counsel that God is given. Maybe we'll just read the 3 and then zero in on verse 11. He that is faithful in that which is least is also faithful in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who will give you that which is your own? But like I said, our focus is in just that verse 11. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, that means you have not been faithful in handling money. who will commit to your trust the what? The true riches. Just this verse alone tells us true riches. They are, it's not monetary. Neither is it what money can buy. True riches is not monetary. Neither is it what money can buy. Now look at James chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. The book of James chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring in a goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile apparel. Hallelujah. So there is a difference in their dressing because of their capacity, you know, to purchase things for themselves. And you have respect to him that wear the gay clothing or the good clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place. And say to the poor, stand thou here or sit here under my footstool. Hear what the scripture says. Are you not then partial in yourselves and are become judges of evil thoughts? Now take note of verse 5. Hearken, my brethren, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he had promised to them that love him? Compared to money and faith, if you are wealthy in faith, you are a truly rich person. God had chosen the poor of this world, what? Rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to them that love him. Hallelujah. God chose them. Why? We will see later as we move on. By the grace of God, why is it, you know, that it is difficult for people who have material wealth, you know, to be chosen by God to be rich in faith and become heirs of the kingdom that God has prepared for them that love him? In Revelation 3, verse 14 to 18, I think this, you know, beautifully puts it to us that material riches, things that money can buy, are not the true riches. Hallelujah. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 18. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things say the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither hot nor cold, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Look at verse 17. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increase with goods, and have need of nothing. Now this is as far as what? Money and material things are concerned, isn't it? Thou sayest, I am rich, increase with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. What does this tell us? A man can have all the things that money can buy, or can have all the money in the whole world, and the person will still be what? Be wretched, be miserable, be poor, be blind, and naked. Now look at verse 18. I counsel thee to buy of me gold, tried in the fire, that thou mayest be what? Be rich. That is real riches. And white raiment, holiness, that thou mayest be what? Be clothed. And that thy the shame of thy nakedness will not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eyesalve, that thou mayest see. The real riches of life, they are not material. Neither are they, is it something that money can buy. It is not money, and it is not things that money can buy. Hallelujah. It is very sad that people value other people. In fact, people value themselves and value other people based on material things and material possession. It's a very unfortunate thing. Hallelujah. You know, that brings something very important. That is one of the, you know, the danger of the prosperity gospel. I want us to know it has brought more damage to the kingdom of God than help. It has. You remember last week we said, Mammon will cause you to focus on the things of this life. One of the greatest damage of prosperity gospel is that it changes your focus from the reality to the obscure. It changes your focus from true riches to temporal riches. It changes our focus from heavenly things to earthly things. Is that not so? It makes us to pursue after things physical eyes can see. It makes us to forget about things eternal. It helps, it makes us focus on things ephemeral. That is why the gospel that sells now is when somebody, you know, must, in their preaching, they must always be talking about you making it, you prospering, you succeeding. If it is not captioned in that, you know, it's like it is not a gospel for our time. It is a damage to the church. It's a damage to the kingdom of God. It's a damage to the advancement of the kingdom. That is why there are multitudes in church and yet no disciples. There are multitudes in church. God cannot commit anything serious to them because what they are pursuing after is not God. They are pursuing, they are serving Mammon. Like we said, they are just using God as a means to an end. My prayer is that God will turn things around in his church in the precious name of Jesus and raise up people who will truly preach the gospel that will set people free, the gospel that will actually prepare the nations for the return of Christ. Remember, Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations and then the end shall come. Not the gospel of prosperity. No, the gospel that deliver people from darkness to light. The gospel that sets them free from sin. The gospel that turns sinners into saints. Hallelujah. The gospel that make people live for Christ only. Die for Christ. The gospel that will make people say, my life is not for me. My life is God's own. That is the gospel that will prepare the nations for the return of Christ. Hallelujah. If you are serving Mammon, you will never be contented in life. That is the deception of Mammon. That's the if anyone pursuing Mammon will never be contented in life. Your life will be about the pursuit of vanity. Your life will, you will never be contented in life. You will go and buy something brand new. If you see somebody with something better, you are not satisfied. You need to get it too. That is Mammon. That is actually how Mammon control people. You will God will bless you to build a house. But because you now saw your friend's house, you are not satisfied. You have to build something better. It is Mammon that breeds competition. It's nothing else. It's not God. Because God never sent us into this world to compete. He sends us into this world to fulfill destiny, not to compete. If you're serving Mammon, you will never be contented. Your life will be about the pursuit of vanity. It is vanity because it will be about the things you cannot take with you when you leave this world. Can you imagine if you live your life pursuing things you cannot take with you when you leave this world? You have lived a vain life. That is living a vain life. In that 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 7 and 8, the book of 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 7 and 8, there the Bible says, for we brought nothing into this world. Take note. How many things did we bring? We brought nothing. Materially speaking, we brought nothing into this world. And it is certain we can carry nothing out. Hallelujah. You know, like I've said before, if you are not certain of anything else, you can be certain of this one thing. You came into this world with nothing. You will take nothing out. I came into this world with nothing. I will take nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be there with content. Hallelujah. Mammon will never make you think about this aspect of life. That is why I say Mammon will obscure you, blind your eyes from reality, make you to pursue shadow all the days of your life. It is when you get to the end that you are now regretting. Why have I wasted my life? You know, like I've said before, on the day of our departure from this world, one of two things will happen to you. You are either regretting the way you've lived your life or you're rejoicing for the way you've lived your life. Nobody will escape it. But for us not to regret, when our time to leave this world comes, we must embrace serving God. We must embrace living for God and for Him only in the precious name of Jesus. Hallelujah. If your life truly belongs to God, then everything that you have also belongs to Him. If your life truly belongs to God, everything that you have also belongs to Him. Not just the tithes and the offerings. Hallelujah. Everything belongs to Him. You know, We can be very happy. We are paying tithes, very happy. We are giving offering, thinking we are doing something big, not knowing that even the offering belongs to God. If our life belongs to God, if we are truly serving God, we will know in ourselves. We will exhibit it in the way we live. Everything else belongs to God, not just the tithes and the offering. Hallelujah. That means God has the right to tell you what to do with what belongs to him. Why? Because he owns it. And he owns it because he owns your life. But if you are serving Mammon, you can tell God. You remember that young man that we came across last week, the rich young ruler, how Jesus said, go and sell everything, give to the poor, come, take up your cross and follow me. He refused. Why? Because he wasn't willing to give his life to God. Hallelujah. In the book of Acts chapter 4, verse 32 to 35, look at how the early disciples gave us practical examples of what it means to serve Jesus and to follow him. Acts chapter 4, verse 32 to 35. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that all of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, brought the prices of the things that were sold, laid them down at the apostles' feet. And I've said before, it's not for the apostle, but for the whole church. Laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according here as he has need. Selfless living. What made them to come to the point and say, what I have does not belong to me? It's because their life belonged to God. Hallelujah. If we belong to God, everything that we have is his own. Hallelujah. Once we truly begin serving God, one of the things that we will get out of our life is selfishness. We will become selfless. As you know, human beings will become selfless human beings. When you meet selfish people, it's because Mammon is still in charge. Hallelujah. When you meet people that are still selfish rather than selfless, it's because they are still under the grip of Mammon. Hallelujah. How else? What is another vanity of Mammon? One of the vanity of serving Mammon is that Mammon will make you to put confidence in material things. Put confidence in money. Your confidence is high when you have sufficient money to take care of your needs. Your confidence is low when there is not enough money, you know, to meet your needs. It's a deception of Mammon. Mammon will make you to place your confidence on money and your confidence on things. But you know, that is not what the Bible asks us to do. Is that not so? God has not asked us to trust in anything material. In fact, the Bible says, if riches increase, don't set your heart on them. Because riches fly away. Because it's vain. The Bible said, trust in the Lord. With what? With all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Hallelujah. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. If your confidence is only high, even in God, because you have enough resources, then you are not totally trusting in the Lord. You are still in the grip. Mammon is still deceiving you. Hallelujah. Or you have confidence because you have a very good employment. You know, there are some people, that's where their confidence is. They have a very good job. That is where their confidence is. No, our trust and confidence must remain in the Lord. Hallelujah. Our trust. That is why, you see, when people's confidence and trust is in money and material things, you know, if they have a good job, God cannot tell them to leave that good job for something else. You understand? God cannot call them from what? Because that is where their confidence is. That is where their trust is. But if your trust is in the Lord, one of the things is that there is nothing God cannot tell you to do. There is nowhere God cannot send you to go. Hallelujah. Why? Your trust is in him. You become a committed follower. Do you know that once we are free from the grip of Mammon, there will no longer be room for anxiety? Once we are free from the deception of Mammon, there will no longer be anxiety. What will I be anxious for or anxious about when my confidence and my trust is in the living God, who can never fail, who can never change, who is all-knowing, who is all-seeing, who is the same yesterday, the same today, and the same forever, who is omnipotent, who owns all the resources of heaven and earth. Once I am free from the deception of Mammon, there will be no more anxiety. Hallelujah. Is that not why God says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. Make your request what? Known to who? Known to God. Make your request known to God. Make your request known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ. Be anxious for nothing. I want us to know, anyone that is still anxious, it doesn't matter what they're anxious about. It is Mammon that is deceiving them. May we be free from the deception of Mammon in the precious name of Jesus. Those who serve God, put their trust in God absolutely. Those who serve God, put their trust in God absolutely. Those who serve Mammon, put their trust in money and in material things. They put their trust in money. You know, like I said about the rich young ruler in Mark chapter 10, verse 21 to 24. It is because he cannot trust God. That was why he couldn't dispose of all the things that Jesus asked him to go and dispose of and come and follow him. He couldn't do it. Hallelujah. And you see, you know, Jesus, when he said, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven, and the disciples were perplexed. In verse 24, the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answered again and said unto them, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? Trust in riches. There are multitudes. Their trust is in their riches. They are confident of the future because of their investment. They are confident of the future because of their life insurance. Not in the living God. They are confident. Their trust is in their riches. And Jesus said, anyone that trusts in riches, it is difficult for them to what? To enter the kingdom of heaven. Because if your trust is in riches, it means you are serving Mammon. You are not serving God. You can't be serving Mammon and make it to heaven. Hallelujah. You remember where we're coming from? You know, you cannot serve God and what? And Mammon. You can. Nobody serving Mammon can make it to heaven. Hallelujah. What would they go and look for? There is no Mammon in heaven. Hallelujah. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17. In 1 Timothy 6, verse 17. Charge them that are rich in this world. Now, this is speaking to believers. That they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches. Did you see? Even if you have the means, even if you have money, your trust must not be in those things. Charge them that are rich in this world, that they be not high-minded, nor trust in what? Uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. Even if you get to a place, you have a good job, good pay, your business is flourishing. The warning is, your trust must not be in those things. Hallelujah. In fact, the Bible called them what? Uncertain riches. When you begin to put your trust in money, it's what? It's uncertain riches. Anything can happen and that money can be gone. There have been multi-billionaires that became poor people. Is that not so? There have been very rich people that became poor. Hallelujah. Our trust must never shift from God, no matter where we get to in life. You know, many that are actually crying and praying for financial breakthrough is so that they will stop trusting God, so that their confidence can shift to, me too, I have money. Hallelujah. Me too. No, they believe that God, you know, they want to have the money because they don't want to be praying about everything. I've had Christians say, must I be praying about everything? I thought that is what the Bible says. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, make your request known unto God. No, there are many in the church. They want to graduate to the level of, they don't want to trust God for any material supply. They don't want to trust God for any monetary supply. No, when they want to buy anything, they will just carry money and buy. That's why they are trusting God, or they are praying hard for breakthrough, fasting and praying, going to all kinds of prayer mountains, not knowing that you can trust God absolutely and you will not even suffer in life. You can trust God absolutely and you will not regret doing so all the days of your life. Hallelujah. To serve Mammon is to choose the path of vanity in life. To serve Mammon is to choose the path of vanity in life. While to serve God is to live a meaningful life on the earth and to prepare for your eternity. You serve Mammon, you have chosen a path of vanity in life. You decide you will serve God all the days of your life. You have chosen a path of meaningful living, life that has satisfaction, life that brings contentment. Hallelujah. And also you are preparing for eternity with God in heaven. In the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 2 and verses 4 to 11, you know, in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 4 to 11, you know, the richest man that ever lived, you know, King Solomon, this was, you know, in the conclusion of his lifetime. Hear what he says. You know, these were some things he did in trying to find satisfaction and meaning to life. I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. I make me gardens and orchards. And I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. I made me pools of water to water therewith the wood that bringeth for trees. I got me servants and maidens, and had servants born in my house. Also, I had great possessions of great and small cattle above all that were in Jerusalem before me. Verse 8, I gathered me also silver and gold, and the peculiar treasure of kings and of the provinces. I got me men singers and women singers, and the delights of the sons of men as musical instruments, and that of all sorts for his personal entertainment. So I was great and increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. And whatsoever, take note, whatsoever my eyes desired, I kept not from them. I withheld not my heart from any joy, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor. And this was my portion of all my labor. Now look at verse 11. Then I look on all the works that my hands has wrought, and on the labor that I had labored to do. And behold, all was vanity and the vexation of spirit, and there was no profit under the sun. What was he saying? In pursuing and doing all those things, he lived a life without profit on the earth. All was vanity. I looked on all the works. What the Bible summarized that we just read. I looked on all the works that my hands had wrought, and on the labor that I had labored to do. And behold, all was vanity and vexation of spirit, and there was no profit under the sun. May we not choose the path of vanity in the precious name of Jesus. No wonder Jesus would say, what shall it profit a man if he what? Gains the whole world and loses his soul. Or what shall a man give in exchange of his soul? Don't live for Mammon. If you do, you have chosen the path of vanity in life. At the end of your life, you will regret it. You will wish you have lived differently. And you know, life is not a dress rehearsal. Hallelujah. Life doesn't have replay. You know, as people have said commonly, you cannot bring back yesterday. You cannot bring back 2019. And so live life meaningfully every moment. Live it for God. Live it for the advancement of his kingdom. That is how every life, every moment of our life will now make meaning. Hallelujah. If you choose to serve Mammon, you automatically become an enemy of the cross of Christ. If you choose to serve Mammon, you automatically become an enemy of the cross of Christ, and your end will be destruction. That is the vanity of serving Mammon. If you embrace the pursuit of Mammon, you automatically become an enemy. The true gospel, that is how you will know whether you are serving God or Mammon. The real gospel will be offending you. the real truth of the word of God will be offending you. If people don't preach what you want to hear, you will not be happy. In fact, you will tune out. You will not listen. You say, no, this is all-time gospel preaching. That is to tell you are in the grip of Mammon. The cross, the way of the cross will become an offense to you. The things of God you used to love before, you will be offended at them. It's because you have fallen into the grip of Mammon. My prayer is that if anyone is in the grip of Mammon, you know, hearing this message, may today be your day of deliverance in the precious name of Jesus. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, the book of Philippians chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, brethren, be followers together of me and mark them which walk so as you have us for an example. Why? For many walk of whom I have told you often and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. What happened? Why? Look at verse 19. Whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. And so what has become of greatest importance to these people is what? Earthly things, material things, material prosperity. That has become their pursuit, that has become their goal, that has become their passion. They became what? Enemies of the cross of Christ. But take note, their end is what? Is destruction. You cannot serve Mammon and make it to heaven, like we said earlier on. If you choose to serve Mammon, you have become an enemy of the cross of Christ. There will be no enemy of the cross of Christ make it to heaven. I mean, how will you reign with Christ when you have met him, your enemy, in your lifetime? My prayer is that may God deliver us from the grip of Mammon in the precious name of Jesus. It was Mammon that made people like the companion of Paul, you know, that has labored with him. Demas labored that even in the book of Colossians, when Paul was greeting the church, even Demas was sending his greeting. Paul's companion in the expansion of the gospel, he got to a point. The Bible said, Demas have left me, have forsaken me, having what? Loved this present world. So the cross of Christ became an offense. He wanted to go and make it too. He wanted to go and make it in, you know, in the world. You cannot serve, you know, Mammon and remain a friend of Christ or a friend of the cross of Christ. That is the vanity. But you see, if you choose that lifestyle, you have just embraced destruction. May that not be our portion in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You know, in conclusion, it will be impossible for your eye to be single until you settle it in your heart to live for God and serve him alone. You know, that's what has brought these teachings these past two Tuesdays. It will be impossible for your eye to be single. Remember where we started from. You know, your eye is the light of your body. If your eye is single, your body will be what? Will be full of light. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is single, your body will be full of light. But if your eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? And that is, you know, after this verse, then verse 24, that says, no one can serve two masters. To truly be the light of the world, for our eyes to be single, we must make up our mind. We must settle in our heart to live for God and to serve him alone. If we don't make that decision, our eyes will not be single. If your eye is not single, you have no light to shine in this life. If your eye is not single, your whole body is full of darkness. You only shine the light that you have. You don't shine light, like I've said. It's not by saying it, I am the light of the world. That is not what it takes to shine. You shine the light, you know, as the light of the world because you have light in you. Because your whole body is full of light. That is when you shine as the light of the world. Hallelujah. And my prayer is that may we truly be the light of the world. But for us to shine as the light of the world, we must settle it in our heart. I will not live for Mammon. I will not die for Mammon. You know, we said last week, some people can take risks to make money. They dare not take risks for the kingdom of God. It's because their master, Mammon, will not allow them to take risks for another master. That is why it's impossible to serve two masters. Hallelujah. I want us to, you know, be on our feet as we appreciate God for sending His word to us. And, you know, appreciate Him tonight and make commitment to Him that we will not turn back from serving Him in the precious name of Jesus. Oh, Father, we thank You. Thank You, Lord. Thank You for Your mercy tonight. Thank You for sending Your word to us again. We bless Your holy name. We glorify Your name. We magnify Your name. Thank You, thank You, thank You. What an awesome God You are. What an awesome God You are. Thank You for sending Your word to us. Thank You for helping us. Thank You for helping us. I know not this message, You are helping us not to be, to remain entangled to Mammon, thinking we are serving You. You are helping us to be very clear in our decision, to be single-minded, to be clear-minded in our decision to serve You. Lord, in the precious name of Jesus, to make the things that matter to You matter to us, not the things that Mammon said, this is what matters. No, not the things of this world that Mammon is painting the picture that this is what matters. That is not You. You are helping us to, Lord, for many whose focus was being distracted or diverted because by Mammon, You are helping us to return back to You. Father, we appreciate You. Oh, we give You all the glory. Blessed be Your holy name. Thank You for Your word to us. Thank You, Daddy. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. You know, one prayer we must pray and continue to pray is, Lord, help me never to live a vain life on the earth. Why must I live my life just for the things of this world? And when I cross into eternity, I have nothing to show for my coming into the earth. If Solomon, the richest man that ever lived, would say that everything he got was just a pursuit of vanity, we should learn from him and not learn from our own experience. I want you to sincerely pray. If you truly want to serve God, except if you are just playing games or you are just being religious, Lord, help me not to live a vain life in the precious name of Jesus. Help me to live a purposeful life. Help me to live a meaningful life. Help me to live life that matters in time and matters in eternity. Help me to pursue eternal realities in the precious name of Jesus. Help me not to live for the things that when my days on earth is over, I will regret my life. Help me not to live for the things that I cannot take with me when I cross to eternity in the precious name of Jesus. Help me not to live a vain life. Help me to, Father, singly pursue You, pursue the, you know, the advancement of Your kingdom all the days of my life in the precious name of Jesus. Your word, as You have told us, my life does not consist in the abundance of the things that I have. Help me, no matter where I am, to be contented. No matter what I have, to be contented. Help me, Father, that no matter what comes my way in terms of monetary and material things, that my trust and confidence will not shift from You. That You will remain my trust, You will remain my confidence in the precious name of Jesus. Father, thank You. Oh Lord, I appreciate You. In praying, Lord, that I will not live a vain life, I am also praying that I will not serve Mammon. I will serve only You. I will serve only You in the precious name of Jesus. I will worship only You. I will not worship man-made God. Father, in the precious name of Jesus. Oh, Father, I bless Your holy name. Oh, we give You all the glory. Thank You, mighty God. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen. Lord, I thank You for Your mercy. Thank You for helping us. Thank You for bringing Your word to us very simply, very plainly, and very clearly. Help us to make the right decision to live meaningful life now in the precious name of Jesus. Anyone whose eyes was obscured by Mammon, that material things are the things that are the reality, the thing they should pursue after. Lord, I thank You that by this message, let the veil be torn away and help every one of us to live real life, life that matters in time, life that matters in eternity also, in the precious name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Help us not just to be hearers of your word. Has anyone, Lord, listening to your message, Lord, have even become offended at the cross? When they hear the true gospel, Lord, they are angry. They want to hear. There is something they want to hear. They just want to hear what excites them. Lord, I am praying. Such a person is turning to you and say, Lord, forgive me. Now I will pursue you. Lord, thank you for having mercy in Jesus' name. Daddy, we bless your holy name. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name.